Bon dia a tothom. Gràcies per la vostra assistència en aquesta quarta xerrada del col·loqui FMUPC que organitzem conjuntament amb la Facultat de Matemàtiques i Estadística i el Departament de Matemàtiques de l'UPC i en aquesta ocasió, a més, amb el suport i la participació activa de la Barcelona Graduate School of Mathematics. Abans que res, permeteu-me que us introduixi a la gent que m'acompanya a la mesa. A la meva esquerra hi ha el José Rodellar, que és el director del Departament de Matemàtiques. A la seva esquerra hi ha el Martí Laoz, que és llicenciat en Matemàtiques per aquesta casa, doctor en Matemàtiques per l'UPC i que ens presentarà el conferenciant. A la dreta del tot tenim el Marc Noy, que és el director de la Barcelona Graduate School of Mathematics, i al meu costat a la Claire Bosen. I am really thankful and it is a honor for us that you have accepted our invitation for this conference. Permeteu-me recordar que aquesta sèrie de col·loquis es va iniciar amb el professor Louis Nirenberg, després va venir el Roger Casals, que havia fet el doblet amb el Rubió de França i el Vicent Casellas aquell any, i el maig de l'any passat vam tenir el professor Andreu Mascolí. Bé, i de moment el que faré és cedir la paraula a les persones que m'acompanyen a la mesa, el professor José Rodellar, director del Departament de Matemàtiques, en primer lloc.
Moltes gràcies. Breument, per mi primer de tot és un plaer i un honor estar aquí a la taula representant el Departament de Matemàtiques i primer de tot també thank you for being here and accepting give this your lecture. Com ja ha dit el Jaume, això és un col·loqui ja sense el quart i esperem que continuï la sèrie, diguem, de manera llarga. Només volia donar les gràcies també a l'assistència i també doncs, per la part que toca al Departament a les persones que han participat en el comitè executiu, diguem, per fer possible l'acte. La Marta Casanellas, soc directora de recerca, de l'equip directiu del Departament, i el Marcel Guàrdia, la Gemma Obet i el Juan Jové, que han estat, diguem, les persones executives en fer possible l'acte. I res més. Gràcies.
Ara té la paraula el professor Marc Noy, el director de Barcelona Graduate School of Mathematics, una iniciativa realment interessant i a la que dirigeix amb molt d'èxit.
Molt bé. Se sent aquí? Gràcies. So thank you for letting us to be here. So in this occasion, the BGS Math Colloquium, we have joined course with UBC, which is, by the way, my home university, so we are very happy. And it is a great occasion to have such a distinguished scholar as Claire Bosen among us. It is a real privilege. I am going to be brief. Let me tell you that we have usually two colloquia during the year. And the spring colloquia, as has been the case for the last 2 years, there will be two lecturers, still undefined, but at least one of the lecturers we would like to take occasion that next year is the year of mathematical biology, and we would like and we will try to have a speaker belonging to this area. So we still had, but we have time. Spring colloquia means May, June, very likely June, as we had last year and the previous year. And just since there are several young researchers here, let me remind you that the main goal of the BGS Math is training at master's, doctoral, postdoctoral level. And currently BGS Math is trying to set up a comprehensive training program for young researchers covering complementary aspects in research, which are every day more needed. So those of you who are not still part of BGS Math, I encourage you to do so. It is very easy. You go to our webpage. There is a sector, a place where you joining the ETS Math, be part of the ETS Math. So if you are not yet registered, please do it. You will receive all kind of information of you will be able to participate in all our actions and training actions, because our goal is really to serve the community of mathematics in terms of training and in terms of research. But let's say one of our main concern is trying to contribute to the training of young researchers in mathematics and related areas in Barcelona. So thank you very much.
Finalment, donem la paraula al Martí Laoz, que, com deia, va ser llicenciat en matemàtiques per aquesta casa l'any 2004, amb el número 1 de la promoció. El mateix any que, per exemple, la Maria Barbero, que també ha fet carrera acadèmica i actualment està a Madrid. Després es va doctorar també a aquesta casa sota la direcció del professor Miguel Ángel Barja. Ha fet estades de recerca a la Universitat de l'Estudi de Roma a Tor Vergata, a l'Ohio State University, a Rio de Janeiro. Ha estat professor ajudant a la UB, postdoc a Bonn, a París Sud i metro de conferències a París 7. I va ser aquí a París on va coincidir, va conèixer la professora Claire Bozan, i és ell qui ha fet les gestions finals per, o el contacte inicial com a mínim per aconseguir que vingués. I ara actualment està en una plaça de Mònica Hall a la Universitat de Barcelona. Doncs quan vulguis ens faràs la introducció de la conferència.
Gràcies. So it's for me a pleasure to present Claire Bozan, who I will try to introduce you briefly. So Claire Bozan studied at the Condor Malan Superior, defended her thesis on the Torelli theorem for cubic bubbles in 1986. She was for 21 years directrice de recherche at the Institut de Mathématiques de Jussieu. In the meanwhile, she spent 2 years at the École Polytechnique and 2 years at the Institut d'Études Scientifiques. Before being elected in 2016, recently, as chair in algebra geometry at the Collège de France, probably the most prestigious academic and research institution in France, consequently recognizing her extraordinarily fruitful and research career. She has been invited all around the world to give very prestigious lectures, as the Chan lectures at Tsinghua University, Fermat Weil lectures at Princeton, and a plenary lecture at the 2010 International Congress of Mathematicians in Hyderabad. She has also directed 11 PhD theses, the last one I think last month, and has been distinguished visiting professor at Princeton, UCLA, and currently at the ETH in Zurich. Claire Bozan has been awarded with an impressive list of prizes and distinctions. The most recent ones, to my knowledge, are the Shaw Prize in 2017 and the Gold Medal of the CNRS 1 year before, in 2016, being the sixth mathematician that has been awarded with this medal that was created in 1954 to distinguish the work of a scientific personality who has made an exceptional contribution to the dynamism and influence of French research. So her work contains several spectacular breakthroughs which have allowed to improve considerably the understanding of algebraic varieties among Keller manifolds, Hodge theory, and more precisely the notion of Hodge structure as introduced by Griffiths, plays an important role in her research as a helpful tool for studying, on the one hand, very important conjectures on algebraic cycles, as the famous Hodge conjecture, but also other conjectures by Grothendieck and Bloch, and on the other hand, to study the topology of complex algebraic varieties. For example, she has used Hodge theory to exhibit topological differences between complex projective varieties and compact Kellen manifolds. Moreover, she has solved, in the general case, the Green conjecture, which concerns the projective geometry of curves in their canonical embedding, and she has contributed to the to study the famous mirror symmetry, which concerns, which is an aspect originated from Gromov-Witten theory of the still rather mysterious relation between algebraic and symplectic geometry. She has contributed to mirror symmetry by constructing explicit mirror families and by computing certain gram-of-beaten invariants. Also, if you are interested on the rationality of algebraic varieties, on their hyperbolicity, on the properties of the period map, or of Chow groups, or of course on Hyperkeller geometry, you will for sure benefit from reading her works or discussing with her. So, I don't want to thank anymore, so let's enjoy the colloquium lecture on Hyperkeller geometry by Kevin Lanzan.
So, thank you very much for the invitation to speak in this colloquium. So, the sort of geometry I'm going to speak about is hyperplane geometry. Was started a period in the 80s on the basis of the work of Yao. And then Yao was in the complex differential geometry setting, and then Bobin in the algebraic geometry setting. This geometry is a little miraculous because it's, as you will see, it is extremely restricted. So I am going to explain what are the restrictions starting from the very beginning. And finally, when we see it from inside algebraic geometry, we realize, and this is an increasing evidence, that there are a lot of these hyperkeller manifolds, and still maybe more than we know already. So it's a little mysterious. I won't be able to explain everything about this geometry because it's really very rich, and you have to. Well, to travel from the very beginning, which is a complex geometry, towards algebraic geometry via Hodge theory. And so it's a long travel to see the whole aspect of the subject. So I try to convey what are the main points. And I mentioned that if you really want to learn more and to follow what is going to happen in the field, you should discuss with Marty, because he is one of the driving forces in the development of the subject inside algebraic geometry. So I said the beginning is a complex geometry. So what is a complex manifold? You start with the idea of a manifold. It's a topological space which is nice locally. That is, it admits locally Cartesian coordinates. And that means that concretely you have charts which are open sets with given homomorphism to open sets of R to the N, and the manifold is then determined by the covering by this chart, and on the overlap of two charts, you have two different sets of coordinates, phi1, the red ones, and phi2, the blue ones, and on the overlap, you can express the new coordinates in terms of the old ones, and there are the change of coordinates maps. In the case of complex geometry, you follow that picture, but you want this chart, the local chart, to take value in open sets of C to the N. And what you want is that the change of coordinate maps, which appear here, are holomorphic, that is, with C linear different charts. So now, when you have made this definition, we see that. On such an X, we have the notion of a holomorphic function, or maybe a holomorphic function defined on an open set. It is a function with value in C, which is holomorphic when you look at it in a local holomorphic coordinate. And the notion does not depend on the choice of coordinates, because when you combine, when you compose your holomorphic function with a change of coordinate map, and you compose a holomorphic function with a holomorphic map, you still get a holomorphic function. So we have this notion of a holomorphic function, and now we apply the general theory of a holomorphic function, which is completely well understood via the Cauchy formula, It says that the holomorphic function is the same thing as a complex analytic function, so it's a uniform limit of a polynomial, so of the complex variable, of course. An important point is the maximum principle, which says that if you have a holomorphic function, it cannot reach at some point the maximum of its absolute value, unless it is a constant near the given point. And as a consequence, we see that the holomorphic functions on a compact complex manifold, they are constant, absolutely constant. So if X is connected, they actually are constant. And I would say it's maybe one of the main difficulties of the subject of complex geometry. And maybe this was the origin of the development of the Schiff theory. It's this lack of global object. Well, of course, we have plenty of local holomorphic functions. Now there is a completely different viewpoint on complex on the notion of a complex manifold. When you consider the associated underlying almost complex structure. An almost complex structure is just when you have a manifold, you give you the structure of a complex vector space on the tangent space at any point. So when you have a real vector space, to make it into a complex vector space, you just have to know how the multiplication by the I, the square root of minus one, will act on it. And so your almost complex structure, it is determined by an operator capital I, which has to square to minus identity. Now, why a complex manifold has an almost complex structure? Because locally, it is by the system of local homomorphic chart, it is homomorphic to C to the N, so that will identify the tangent spaces to the tangent space to C to the N, so to C to the N. So that gives you the local complex structure. You have to, on tangent space, you have to check that they do not depend on the choice of coordinates, but precisely the change of coordinate maps, they are homomorphic, so their differential is C linear, and this way you see that the almost complex structure defined in one homomorphic chart that does not change when you pass to another homomorphic chart. And finally, the relationship between complex structure and almost complex structure has been understood much rather late by Newlander and Erdmann, and they tell us exactly what are the almost complex structures, which are coming from a complex structure in that sense. And the conclusion is that there is an integrability condition on I, which looks like a sort of a Frobenius integrability condition, which guarantees that the I comes from a complex structure. So let me give some examples. I will give two examples which are very important for the subject and in general for complex geometry, but very different in spirit. One is the complex projective space. It is the ambient space for algebraic geometry. Overseas would be complex algebraic geometry. As I said, the complex manifolds, the compact complex manifolds, they do not have non-constant holomorphic function, so the embedding problem for us is certainly not embedding into C to the N. Because of this, we need another sort of ambient space, and the projective space is the one that we use in algebraic geometry. So as a set, the complex projective space is the set of lines, that is a one-dimensional vector spaces in C to the N plus 1. Topologically, it's the compactification of the affine space C to the N. The picture is here, it's the case of the real projective space. So the reason is that suppose that you choose a linear coordinate Z on C to the N plus 1. Then the lines which are not contained in the hyperplane Z equals 0, they will have a unique generator which satisfies Z equals 1. And this way you have a copy of this fine hyperplane inside your complex projective space. And what is missing is the set of lines which are contained in the hyperplane z equals 0, and this is called sometimes the hyperplane at infinity. So now to make this object into a complex manifold, you do this. Now this z, you can choose for z, you choose the basis of z to the n plus 1 dual, so capital xi. And so for each I, you have an affine open set as just described, which is xi equal 1, it's a copy of this affine open set inside this CPN. And on it, you have natural coordinates where it is a restriction of the capital X coordinate. And by definition, the I plus 1 is a set 1. Now, so that gives the chart, and the change of a chart are very easy, because if you consider this vector, which is represented in this open set, and this vector, which has the g plus 1 coordinates equal to 1, they are proportional, so they generate the same line. So that exactly tells you what is the change of coordinates between these two charts. They are given here, the new coordinates for this chart. They are given in terms of the old coordinate by this formula. So it's holomorphic. In fact, it's algebraic. So in particular, the CPN is a complex manifold. It turns out it is an algebraic variety. It has a lot of meromorphic functions. So the small xi, which are small fg, which are here, they extend the meromorphic domain on CPN. So this is, of course, very important for us. Now, the second easy to define compact complex manifold, but usually not related to algebraic geometry, is the complex Torah. So rather, the complex Torah, because unlike the complex projective space, the complex Torah, they have deformations. So there is not a unique complex structure on them. So how they are defined as a topological object, you consider the R, even dimensional real vector space, and you mod it out by the action of a lattice z to the 2n inside it. That means that in the quotient, the two points will be identified if they differ by a point with integer coordinates. So the picture is here. Here it's a two-dimensional, the lattice is generated by A1, A2. And then, of course, when you want to get the torus, then you have to identify points which differ by the vector A2, and then points which differ by the vector A1. So the conclusion is that you have to glue the blue line with the blue line here, the red line with the red line here, and at the end you get this nice picture. And now I want to make it into a complex manifold. For this, you just choose a complex structure of a complex vector space or on your R2n. As I said, it's just choosing an endomorphism I, which squares to minus identity. So that makes your R2n to be naturally isomorphic to C to the 2n. And then I said that this induces a structure of a complex compact manifold on the quotient. And the reason is that on this torus, you have natural charts which are obtained as well. So you choose a small chart on R2n, which is which is small enough that no two points are identified. So that gives you that will be immersed into your torus, and you will get at least one chart. And then you for the other chart, you just translate this one so as to cover the role of R2n or the role of the fundamental parallelogram. And now when you look at the transition, the change of chart map for this system of charts, now just given by translation by a constant vector. But translations they are clearly holomorphic, so that gives you the structure of a complex manifold. Now, as I said, most complex torus, starting from dimension 2, they are not related to algebraic geometry. But in fact, they have a property in common with projective space, namely they are Kellermann manifolds. So I want to explain what is this geometry. I like it very much because it's the geometry which makes compatible Riemannian geometry, symplectic geometry, and complex geometry. So the general notion of a Riemannian metric on a manifold is a tool for of a structure of a Euclidean or Euclidean metric on the tangent space at any point. So if you have a local coordinate, that gives you a basis to the realization of the tangent bundle, the basis of the tangent space, and so the matrix, the metric is given by the matrix G, A, G. Riemannian geometry is the data of this matrix. Now we are working in complex geometry, so the tangent space has a complex structure at any point, so it makes sense to speak about a Hermitian metric on the tangent space at any point. Now, now we consider local holomorphic coordinates, the one to the n, they will give us natural basis. As to understand what is this symbol, the delta over delta zi, for the tangent space of the at any point as a complex vector space. So now the Hermitian matrix is only given by Hermitian matrix Hij of x. Now so finally you will have this Hij, which is a matrix with a infinite coefficient. If you look at it, the real part, of course, it will give you a Riemannian metric in the usual sense, but the imaginary part of this matrix, of this tensor, as you can see easily from the fact that the Hermitian matrix is a sesquilinear, the imaginary part, it is a two-form. This two-form, it is called the Keller, it's a real two-form, it is non-degenerate at any point, and it is called the Keller form of the metric. But we are not yet in the Keller context. The definition of a Keller metric is that the metric is Keller if this, if the Keller the Keller form is closed. So when you see the Keller, why I said that it is related to symplectic geometry, because then the two form it is a symplectic form on this symplectic structure on the Keller manifold. Well, of course, it's not so obvious to see at first sight why the notion is interesting. I think you understand this much better if you use that that other characterization, which says that the metric is scalar if and only if the operator I, which is a section of the bundle of endomorphies on the tangent bundle, is parallel for the Levi-Civita connection associated to this metric G. And as a consequence, there is a characterization of Keller manifolds, or manifolds with complex manifolds equipped with a Keller metric, as the purely Riemannian characterization, as those manifolds, Riemannian manifolds with holonomy contained in the unitary group. That is the holonomy. You use a parallel transport associated to the Levi-Civita connection along a long path, and along loops you will get something which is usually non-trivial, and the holonomy being preserved by left invariant by the monodromy for a tensor is the same as the fact that you have a globally defined parallel tensor. And so, of course, G is always invariant by the holonomy group. Parallel transport preserves the metric. But now we have the condition that I is also parallel, and finally the holonomy group preserves both G and I, which means that it is contained in U of N. And the converse, it's very nice, it's the fact that if you have this condition, in fact the metric, the I satisfies the integrability condition. So now associated to a Keller manifold, you have the Durham cohomology class, which is, you have this Keller form, which is closed, and you take its cohomology class, which is the Durham cohomology, with real coefficients. It is close to France, below exact ones. So the examples are all the objects that we know in some sense. For example, in the case of Riemann surfaces, it's very nice because you have a Riemann surface, a priori, is just a surface, an oriented surface with a metric. And in that case, everything comes together. First of all, the complex structure comes with a metric because, to know the complex structure, you just have to know the operator I, multiplication by I. But when you have the metric plus the orientation, you define the I to be the rotation, the positive rotation of angle pi over 2, that is the only rotation which is square to for this metric, which is square to minus identity, and you use the rotation to make it turn in the right direction. So you have the complex structure. It is integrable for dimension reasons, that is the integrability condition is not, you don't see it in that case. The metric is a Hermitian, it's automatic also for dimension reason. And it is scalar, again, it's automatic for dimension reason because the d omega will be tree form, so zero on the surface. And I think that also the reason why the subject of complex geometry did not progress very much before the 20th century is because in the surface case, everything comes mixed, and in particular, these various integrability conditions that have appeared before, you don't see them in that case. And the other example is a case of a complex toroid, or as I said, you can put a complex structure on a you choose a complex structure, then to define a Keller metric, you just put a Hermitian metric in the usual sense on your C to the n. And it descends, it's a translation invariant, so it descends to give a Keller metric on the torus. The d omega equals zero is obvious because the omega upstairs it is constant and so on. And these metrics they are not so interesting in some sense because they are flat. So maybe not extremely exciting. But the projective space is also Keller. There are explicit Keller metrics which are obtained. I will explain in a minute how we can get such metric. So the Fubini steady metric is an example of a Keller metric which is invariant under a big group of automations of complex projective space. And it follows that projective complex manifolds are Keller. So the projective complex manifolds, they are the complex submanifolds of a complex projective space, or a priori, they are those which are defined locally by holomorphic equations. And it turns out that this is one of the miracles of a projective geometry, that complex projective manifolds can also be defined as algebraic singularities or submanifolds of complex projective space. Namely, there are those which are defined by polynomial equations, homogeneous polynomial equations. So it's a result due to Shaw, which is extremely important for us because, when I say us, I mean people working in complex algebraic geometry. That even if you are interested in algebraic geometry, you can do computation in the analytic setting where you replace polynomials with holomorphic functions, and all what you do there is still valid in the context of algebraic geometry. So this result about complex projective manifolds being algebraic has been generalized by Serre. This is what is called the Gagarin principle. Okay, so now so I said that the complex toroid and the projective space are both Keller. It turns out that the Keller class on the complex projective space It is related to well, it can be produced by from geometric object on a projective space. So the notion is here it's very important, the holomorphic line bundle. So holomorphic line bundles or algebraic line bundles in general, they are there to solve this embedding problem that I mentioned, the lack of a global holomorphic non-constant global holomorphic function on a compact complex manifold or even a projective one. So I suppose that you have a projective complex manifold, so that it has plenty of neuromorphic function. I explain that there's a small deshomogeneous XLG appearing before, they are neuromorphic function. When you have a neuromorphic function, locally you can write it as a quotient of two holomorphic functions, f over g. But certainly not globally, because there are no non-constant holomorphic functions. Now it's not, there is no mystery, it's not paradoxical. The point is that when you write your phi as f over g, the writing is not unique. You can multiply both f and g by holomorphic, invertible holomorphic function, that is holomorphic function with value in C star. So, and the conclusion is that the better way to understand what are the f and g is as holomorphic sections of a certain holomorphic line bundles, which is exactly created to understand to solve that problem. Namely, so you write your phi as f over g locally, so they produce fi, fi gi. And there, when you change the open set, you will have a different writing with FD and GD. Mm-hmm. And that was that introduced a transition function, which are invertible holomorphic function, FID, such that FD is FID, FI, and GD is FID and GI. And then this way, you see that. You should see the F as the data of this FI, and this is a section of okay. So the general idea of well, which has been a very important starting point of algebraic complex algebraic geometry under the impulse of Codeira, with the Codeira embedding theorem, is that these holomorphic line bundles, so we don't have any holomorphic function, but we may have line bundles with many holomorphic sections. And the reason is that the holomorphic line bundle, it has some curvature which helps to have a non-zero section. So now associated to a line bundle, don't think to holomorphic. Here the FIG is holomorphic, but more generally you can consider topological complex line bundles. In that case, the transition functions will be just continuous functions with value in this star. When you have such an object, which is a topological object, you have an associated first chain class, which is an integral cohomology class, that's a topological invariant. So there are now many different ways to get it, particular. Your complex line bundle is topologically it's the same as an oriented rank 2 vector bundle, and as such it has an Euler class. So it's a way of defining the C1. But for us, the important definition is the fact that the chain class can be computed as a curvature. So in particular, if you take any connection on your line bundle, now it has to be at least a differentiable. When I say connection, I think to a complex C-linear connection. You can consider its curvature. It is close to form. So basically, in fact, you have to divide this close to form. It's a close to form with complex coefficient. You have to divide it by 2i pi. And the form that you get will be a real then, and then the class of this form will be the Doran representative for the first chain class. And now the name of the chain come here. I am now in the holomorphic setting, and there is a way of constructing a canonical representative for this first chain class once you have a Hermitian metric on your line model. So you consider each Hermitian metric, so it is at least a differentiable, or maybe it's infinite. And then I want to construct a two form which will be closed and represent this first term class. And for this, choose any holomorphic section of the local definition. Choose a non-zero section sigma of n. Then log h of sigma is well defined, and you can consider it's d d bar, so it gives you a two form, and then when you divide by two alpine, you get a real one-one form, which is also closed. And in fact, it turns out that this expression is exactly the curvature of a certain connection, called the Chern connection. And so you get a representative of your sigma. Okay. And now here comes the part. When you have compact complex manifold, it always comes equipped with at least one holomorphic line bundle, which is a canonical line bundle. Namely, you have the holomorphic vector bundle, which is locally in local holomorphic coordinate generated by your local holomorphic coordinate will be z1 to zn, and you consider the corresponding differential dz1 to the dzn, and you consider what is generated by these objects with the coefficients holomorphic functions. And that gives you a holomorphic vector bundle, which is basically it's relationship with the usual cotangent bundle, or the infinite cotangent bundle. It's not totally trivial. You can see it as follows. So if you consider the corresponding C-infinite vector bundle, the omega, which is the chief of the bundle of holomorphic differential, it is a set of complex one forms, which are C-linear. So it's only one half of the bundle of one forms on your X. Okay, so now we have this holomorphic vector bundle, so you can take its determinant, it's the top exterior power, and this is a holomorphic line bundle, which is called canonical. So now what I explained is the Gao theorem, which has been very important for the development of algebraic geometry, and also for the development of this subject of Calabi-Yahoo and hyperkeller geometry. So now you have your X, which has a Keller metric. Then associated to this Keller metric, you have the Riemannian volume form. But it turns out that it is omega to the n over n factorial. It's very important. But you can see this volume form as giving a Hermitian metric on maybe not the canonical bundle, but it's inverse. It's very important. And so associated to this Hermitian metric, you can consider the associated Chern form exactly as I defined before. And this Chern form, as I explained, it represents the canonical the first Chern class of C1 of Kx. And now the result of Yao, so I stated in the case of trivial canonical class, it is the following. So suppose that this class is zero as a cohomology class. Then now if you fix any Keller class on X, in here, in H2 of XR, then there exists a unique Keller form omega prime which has the same Keller class. That means that the omega prime is omega plus something which is exact. That's a little more about that. So it's in the same cohomology class plus the condition that the associated chain form lambda kx omega prime is zero. So said like this, it's not totally obvious why it is interesting, but in fact there is a holonomy interpretation. So as I explained, the Keller condition is the fact that the holonomy group is contained in U of n. I think it's not a restricted holonomy group. It should be the holonomy group here. Now it turns out that this vanishing here it's for a reason which is not totally trivial. In fact, it is equivalent to the fact that the metric that we have, really purely on the Riemannian side, it is a Ricci flat. So the Ricci curvature is zero, and it's not totally trivial. It's the fact that in fact this form, it is a two form. The real one-one form. It turns out that in the Keller situation, it is in fact essentially the same thing as the Ricci curvature, which is not obvious because the Ricci curvature it's not a two-form; it's a symmetric tensor. But there is sort of a way of going from a symmetric tensor to alternate tensors. And when you use this, you can really identify this object with a Ricci curvature. So finally, this vanishing condition, it's equivalent to saying that the metric is Ricci flat, or that the restricted holonomy group is now contained in SU. Okay. So now we are going to make metrics of more and more restricted. Holonomy. So, now I am going to speak about this Calabi-Yau geometry. So Calabi-Yau, a priori, it comes from Yau, of course, because of this theorem. This theorem was the solution to the Calabi conjecture. So the general context is a context of compact Keller manifolds with trivial first charm class, C1 of Kx is equal to 0. And now, what Bovin and also Bogomolov independently proved is that using, in fact, Yao's theorem, that this Calabi-Yau manifold essentially are made up to finite total covers. They are classified in three tapes, so they are products of three sorts of Calabi-Yau manifolds. And the three sorts of segments that we get are the ones that we already met, the complex tori, which are flat. The second are what we call Calabi-Yau in the strict sense, and the third are the hyperkeller manifolds that we that are the subject of this lecture. So the result is this. So if you have a compact Keller manifold with trivial canonical class, then there is a finite total cover of it, which is isomorphic as a complex manifold to a product complex torus times these products of Calabi-Yau manifolds times hyperkeller manifolds. So now the Calabi-Yau manifolds which are here, they differ from the WD by the structure of the space of holomorphic forms. So for the another way to distinguish them is that they do not have the same type of of whole nonomic groups. Here, in that decomposition, the semens YI and WG are all simply connected, so you don't need to make a difference between the restricted holonomic group and the global holonomic group. So for the Calabi-Yau case in the strict sense, the holonomy, they admit the matrix of holonomy exactly the group SU. I said that here the metric that we are going to consider are metrics of holonomy group contain SU. So in the Calabi-Yau case, we want to have a matrix of holonomy exactly the group SU. And the last tape, so they have still a smaller holonomy. They have metrics of a smaller holonomy group. Now they are of even complex dimension, and they admit metrics of holonomy the group SP of 2MG. So what is this group? So you consider C to an even dimensional complex vector space. On it, you put the standard Hermitian metric and the standard form, some standard two form, sigma from I of 1 to n of EI wedge EN plus I. That gives you the. So, and what we call the group SP of 2M is a subgroup of automorphism of C to the 2M, preserving these two data. Maybe I can say something about this decomposition theorem. It is obtained by applying you start with the Yau theorem, which first gives you there exists a Ricci flat metric. And then these metrics they have restricted holonomy contained in the group SU, as I said. And then they apply classification due to Marcel Berger. Of the possible restricted holonomy group. And basically, the conclusion is that the holonomy group, the restricted holonomy group, has to, its action split the tangent bundle as a product of three semens. One is the flat part where the holonomy is trivial. The second is the product of direct semen where the holonomy is a restricted holonomy is a full SU group, and the third is a product of a semen where on each semen the holonomy restricted holonomy is the group SP. And so at that moment, what is obtained is only a decomposition of the tangent bundle into a direct orthogonal direct sum of sub-bundles where the holonomy is this and this. And then it's a fact that this decomposition it's a flat, and when going to the universal cover of your X, it will lead to a decomposition of the X itself. So you have to show that the distribution that you get are integrable, and that your result is the RAM, I believe, that when you have this decomposition of the tangent bundle, you get accordingly a decomposition of if your X is simply connected as a product of a Riemannian manifold. And then there are again another ingredient which is really hard to explain why the semens that we have here they are in fact compact simply connected. So so for example an extra information that this theorem gives compared to the Yau result. So Yau said that there are metrics of of restricted holonomy contain in SU. And if you think to this information in terms of complex geometry, it is saying that the canonical bundle has a connection with trivial curvature. But what could have been possible, a priori, is that what we get is just a holomorphic line bundle with flat structure. But that usually does not say that after taking going to a finite cover, this holomorphic line bundle becomes trivial. This is, so the extra information that is contained in this theorem is that this line bundle, in fact, it is a torsion in the Picard group. Or if you like, after we go into the finite cover, the canonical bundle as a holomorphic line bundle becomes trivial. And this is the real information which was not, absolutely not contained in the Yao theorem. So now, hypercanon geometry. This is the last, well, there's a cement which appeared in the Bobby locomotive decomposition. So a hypercanon manifold, it's a simply connected compact Kellermann manifold admitting Kellermann metrics of holonomy, so dimension, sorry, I should say, dimension 2m admitting Kellermann metric of holonomy sp of 2m. The Kellermann metrics, they are not unique, by the Yao theorem, they are unique once you fix the Keller class. But there are many possible Keller class, they form and equivalently, there is a definition of this manifold, which does not involve any metric. There should be, of course, a compact Keller, simply connected, and they should admit the unique, if very well non-degenerate, holomorphic two-form sigma x. And the reason why these two definitions are equivalent is the fact that if you have a Bochner principle, if you have a metric, a Keller metric, which is Ricci flat, and your x is compact, then the holomorphic tensors are parallel. Conversely, if you have a form of type K0 which is parallel, it is closed, and finally it is holomorphic. So that means that under this Ricci flat assumption, once you restrict the holonomy, you produce holomorphic forms, those which are invariant under the holonomy, and vice versa. Okay. I said that this geometry is extremely restricted, and one reason is the fact that these varieties X not only are complex manifolds, but they are quaternionic manifolds, which means that they carry the attendant space carry an action. They are naturally quaternionic vector space. There is an action of the field of quaternion on it. So let me explain how it is obtained. So you have your X, which has a Keller Einstein metric, this Keller form omega. And on the other hand, as I said, there is also this form, this holomorphic two form sigma. And then you can write, you can produce G and K, which are automorphisms of the tangent, the real tangent bundle, by this formula. That is, the real part of sigma will be given as the omega of u, g times the thing, and the imaginary part of sigma will be given by omega u, so that defines for you the g and the k. And then you can verify that, in fact, you may have to rescale your sigma by dividing it by the real constant. The triple I G K satisfies the quaternionic relation that is G squared is minus T, K squared is minus T, I G is minus G A is minus K, etc. And this way you produce an action of of the quaternions. But in fact, there is more, because you see, now if I consider my g and my k, they satisfy g to the square equal minus 1, so minus identity, so that gives another almost complex structure. But in fact, as I mentioned already, everything is parallel for the Levi-Civita connection. Because the Keller form, it is parallel, sigma x, it is parallel, that's what I explained before, by the Bochner principle, and so the conclusion is that G is parallel. And then we conclude that G is in fact integrable, so the G which is here, it produces in fact another complex structure. And you can make this reasoning for the whole sphere of pure quaternions. So inside, the quaternions is generated by one g, I, j, and k. The pure quaternions are generated by I, j, and k. And inside, there are those of square minus one in which form a sphere. And for any linear combination of I, j, and k, which is in this sphere, you get a complex structure on your x. So in fact, it's more than just the action of the quaternion on the tangent space at each point. It's really a whole sphere of complex structures. In fact, all these complex structures have the properties that they are Keller for the fixed metric g. The Keller form changes, but the metric itself remains fixed. So this is very beautiful. That also says that if you have a hyperkeller manifold, it's very easy to deform it, because you have all these twistor lines, which are very global deformations of the complex structure, and they are called twistor lines. So I won't have time to explain the beautiful properties of the moduli space of the deformation theory of hyperkeller manifold, but it's an essential part of the subject. But already it's nice to see that because deforming a complex manifold is really very hard. That thing in the Kuranishi sense, you start from your complex manifold. It is given by the complex structure is determined by your almost complex structure operator. When you want to deform it, you are just going to deform this I to some IT, which still satisfies this condition that IT to the square is minus identity. So that is quite easy. But then you have to impose that the integrability condition remains satisfied. You have to solve this equation. So finally, using that method and taking a coefficient by a group of diffeomorphism, we get the Kuranishi family. But really, it's a very hard process, and we meet difficulties in the fact that the space of solutions to the integrability conditions might be singular. That is what we say, the distance of obstruction to the deformation. And in fact, they do not appear here, the particular case of an important reason due to Bogomolov, Tian, and Todorov, that the deformations of hyperkeller manifolds are unobstructed, what we can see from the existence of. Okay, so as you have seen, this geometry, this hyperkeller geometry, it's the result of restricting, and finally having extremely special objects. And the surprise is that, in fact, there are many such objects that have been built progressively from algebraic geometry. And there are some works which are done now in algebraic geometry, not only to construct new sort of examples, but also to understand their deformation species inside algebraic geometry. So there is a lot of beautiful things to do there. But from the beginning, we had the case of K3 surfaces, which is slightly less spectacular because they are only of dimension 2. They are a little special because, in some sense, you could say, argue that the K3 surface, they are both Calabi-Yau and hyperkeller. And if you look at the definition via the non-existence of holomorphic forms in intermediate degree. Qu'est-ce que se fait? There are defined as compact Keller surfaces with trivial canonical bundle and simply connected. And it's rather easy, at least by now, maybe that was not that easy in the 80s, to show that there is only one topological tape and are all obtained by, for example, starting from a degree 4 hypersurface in CP3. Of course, you want it to be smooth, and then you see it is simply connected by general methods due to the shapes and the topology of hypersurfaces. And it has trivial canonical bundle by the second adjunction for now. So that gives examples. But conversely, you can choose that any K3 surface is a deformation of this one. And there is a very nice example for this. You have to. It's because we know very well the deformation theory, and we have to show that we, starting from any K3 surface in that sense, you can deform the complex structure so that some line bundle appears which allow to embed the K3 surface in K3, so as to get a surface of degree 4. So it's a really nice, it's not hard by now, but it's very nice. But then, in higher dimensions, other examples have been constructed and by Bovin, maybe also Fujiki. So, as the so-called Hilbert scheme, so it's a beautiful construction of algebraic geometry. If you consider the symmetric product of a surface, unlike the curve case, you get something which is similar. You can say it's very easy to see locally what happens with two points. You have to take the quotient by the evolution, extending the two points, and you see that near the diagonal, you get the singular. But then you can desingularize it. In the case of two points, it's just blowing up the singular locus of the diagonal. The object that we get here is the so-called the Hilbert scheme. Instead of the symmetric product, you parameterize just the data of k unordered points plus some multiplicities. And the Hilbert scheme, it parameterizes much more refined object, namely subschemes of length k of s. So that might be, for example, if you have a point with multiplicity 2, the subscheme with that associated point, there will be a point plus the tangent vector. Multiplicity 3, it's more complicated because that might be a point, but again supported on a point. A point plus a tangent vector plus a sort of acceleration vector, it's called a curvilinear scheme. And there is another sort of a subscheme of supported of a point on a point and of length 3, which is the full infinitesimal neighborhood of a point, like x, plus all possible tangent direction at this x, that gives you, so that's the meaning of the picture that explains what happens when the points collide, and then when the case of three points, you have this example, which is a point plus all the tangent vectors, and this is a curve. And then Bovill explained that if S is a K3 surface, SK are hyperkeller, and the terminology by now is that they are crepant resolutions of the symmetric product. So I would like to finish by explaining, for a very long time, almost 15 years, we knew only the Hilbert scheme of K3 surfaces and a similar series built also by Bovill starting from an abelian surface or a complex torus of dimension 2, which are called the generalized Kummer variety. And in about 1998, O'Grady came with a really new example because it does not have the topology of the Hilbert scheme. So let me describe quickly how it is done. So the generalization of the Hilbert scheme construction is essentially due to Mukai. You construct moduli spaces of maybe not vector bundles, but say coherent sheaves, which are essentially vector bundles with possible singularities. And if you consider the stable object, then they are simple, and the Kai shows that the modular space that you get is it has a non-degenerate holomorphic two-form. And when it is compact, that gives you, in fact, a Hyper-Kellermann manifold. So that is very nice, but then Yoshio-Karp proves that by this construction, you do not get more. You do not get new deformation tapes, in the sense that all that were constructed this way were, in fact, deformations of varieties of Hyper-Kellermann manifolds of type SN. Now, when they are non-compact, you can compactify them by adding the semi-stable ones. But that produces singularities. And in most cases, these singularities cannot be resolved staying in the K-trivium or Hyper-Keller situation. And O'Grady found one example where it works. And this is a case where you consider semi-stable sheaves of rank 2, trivial determinant, and C2 is 4. The dimension is TBM and ROR, is a 10. This modular space of semi-stable, non-stable objects, just take Z1 and Z2, which are subschemes of length 2 of S, and then the direct sum IZ1 plus IZ2, well, it's a coherent sheaf, it is semi-stable, and it has the right term number, but clearly it is not stable, and it produces a singularity. And O'Grady shows that, nevertheless, this object has a Hyper-Keller direct dissimulation that is a crepante dissimulation is a crepante, basically that the canonical bundle is trivial, and that is not enough to keep the Hyper-Keller. And he computed the second Bettinian number, which is 24, unlike the S to the N, for N at least 2, it is, the B2 number is 23. So this one is an easy. And I finish with a result of due to Lada, Saka, and myself, which was building on previous ideas. So the general idea of this whole subject is that K-tree surfaces, algebraic K-tree surfaces, they have 19 parameters. But if you look at S2 or S to the n for n at least 2, the algebraic deformations have at least 20 parameters. So the general deformation is not coming from a K-tree. And there was a miraculous construction of Hyper-Keller due to, the first one was due to Bovin and Donaghy, of a Hyper-Keller manifold associated to a cubic fourfold. The cubic fourfold, they are defined by a cubic equation in P5. If you compute the parameters, they are 20 because you have a 56 dimensional vector space of degree 3 polynomial, and the outmorphic group is of dimension 36. So you get 20 parameters. And it turns out that Bovin and Donaghy already proved that if you consider the Fano variety of lines contained in a cubic fourfold, it is a Hyper-Keller manifold of dimension 4, and that produces already producing a 20 parameter family of Hyper-Keller manifolds. So there have been other works of in a similar spirit. And what we have done in this paper is that we similarly reconstructed the deformation of the O'Grady manifold, or deformations of the O'Grady manifold, starting from a cubic fourfold. Using the so-called associated Jacobian intermediate Jacobian vibration. So if you have a cubic fourfold, you consider the smooth hyperplane section, they are cubic trifolds. And the cubic trifolds, they have associated complex torine, which have been first defined by Griffiths, and they are the analog of the Jacobian for a curve. That provides for you a family of five-dimensional Abelian varieties, and the basis is the space of hyperplanes, an open set in P5 dual. where the radiofin section is concerned. And it was known to Donaghy and Nachman that this, the total space, which is now 10-dimensional, has a non-degenerate closed holomorphic two form. And what we proved is that if X is general, the question of X has to be taken in general in an open set. This intermediate Jacobian fibration admits a smooth compactification, which is a fiber over P5 dual, and it is which is a hyperkeller, and these varieties that we construct are deformations of the Grady effort. So now, I'm sorry, I am that. Now there are plenty of similar works which have been done, in particular the work of Marty with collaborators related to category theory and the cubic four folds, and provides a wonderful development of the. Of that subject. And I should also mention that one should not be obsessed with the cubic four folds because there are other auxiliary varieties which have been involved in the subject and which allow the similar construction of hyperkeller manifold. So the subject is still still in progress. Right? So,
preguntas?
Okay, if a hyperkeller manifold has a non-degenerate symplectic, a non-degenerate holomorphic two form, which is of integral cohomology class?
It's not possible.
Okay.
It's not possible because of the Hodge decomposition theorem. Yeah. It tells you that there is a H20. Decompose the cohomology with complex coefficient into value state, and 2-0 cannot be mixed with 0-2.
Okay.
If it was integral, it would be real in particular. This notion of integrality is very important, not for the symplectic form, the holomorphic symplectic form, but for the Keller form. I did not mention here because I could not make the whole story of algebraic geometry, but when the Keller form omega, but you see, in the hyperkeller setting, there are twistor lines which mix somehow the holomorphic symplectic structure and the Keller structure. But in any case, if the Keller form has an integral cohomology class, this is a famous integral Leydig theorem. In that case, the X is projective. So that's why it's very easy to show that all hyperkeller manifolds have deformations which are projective and just deform a little the complex structure. So as you get to make the Keller class integral.
So, but can this non-degenerate holomorphic two form be the characteristic class of a foliation still or something like that?
I don't know.
Okay.
So in any case, I think that with these twistor lines, you see very well how the two forms, and from the differential geometry viewpoint, how they are built.
Okay. Thank you.
So when you consider the twistor line, the collection of complex structures, I guess you get a map from S2 to the model state of complex structures.
Absolutely.
Can you characterize this map in terms of a PDE? Mm-hmm. What kind of maps from S2 to the model space appear as coming from a hyperkeller structure?
In fact, we understand extremely well we have this space. They are not inside nowhere. Because, in fact, I have no time to mention this, but we understand perfectly the deformation theory of a hyperkeller manifold in terms of the period domain. In fact, there is a sort of miracle, which is the Bobil-Bogomolov quadratic form, Q, on cohomology of degree 2. This Q, so that, quadratic form, and it defines a quadric in the projective space of a degree 2 cohomology with complex coefficients. And the general deformation result is that, well, if you have a sigma, which is this form of L2, 0, it's class, it satisfies Q of sigma is equal to 0. Well, it's more or less the definition of the quadratic form which exists. And the deformation result says that deforming the complex structure, it is exactly the same as deforming the class sigma staying in this quadric. So, and now, when we adopt this viewpoint, the twist or light, they are very simple. You have your situation, sigma plus omega. Now, you have three real two forms for the two classes, namely the real part of sigma, omega, and the imaginary part of sigma. So that generates a real space of dimension 3 inside the cohomology of the V2. Now consider the complexified space that gives you a C3 and inside this C3 on the associated projective space of C2, you get a conic defined by Q equals 0. And the twist or line, it is there. So it's not going in the direction of analysis, but from the viewpoint of the period map, what we call the period map, it's actually very simple.
In the previous slide, you said that if you have a K3 surface S, then S, oh wait, I think the one before, sorry. Yes, then SK is hyperkeller. But you said before also that if you have an entire cover, then one of the components is hyperkeller. So my question is, does SK appear as an entire cover of something interesting?
I think not in general, because there are some examples. To have this situation, your question is equivalent to saying, to asking whether the SK has an interesting automorphism, which is, say, for example, for finite order and acting without fixed point. And that exists, but I think not in general. So for example, already for k equal 1, so in the case sk is S itself, there are examples of k3 surfaces that depends on the complex structure. I mean, there are k3 surfaces which admit an involution which is without which is a fixed point free, and so that means that they are in the cover of surfaces which were classified as Henriques surfaces. So, and I think that people like maybe Boissière, Caméré, Sarti, they have investigated the existence, or maybe also Ogizo, they constructed what they call a general Henriques manifold, that exactly basically obtained as a quotient of the generalization of Henriques surfaces obtained as a quotient of the scalar operators by fixed country automorphism.
Let me just ask a question. For the generalized Kummer, are there families of four-dimensional families, or are they not, or where to look for them, or?
So let me remember. I think there is one constructed by Ramstadt. All that I mentioned has a sort of a parallel development, where instead of starting from a Kittel surface, you start from an Abelian surface. So the same objection could be made, namely if you consider the generalized cohomology, it's Picard-Rank, it's too big. I mean, the deformation that you get, they are not all the algebraic deformation of the generalized Kummer. I think at least one case, well, it's much less developed than the situation of the K3. The full, complete theory of deformation has been explicitly constructed. But I think that there is no the analog of the result concerning the spectral O'Grady, because O'Grady also has a sort of exotic example where he did desingularize the moduli space of a shift on the Hadamardian surface. And for this one, I don't think we have the analog of this 20 parameter which is obtained by using the cubic for program.
So that's it.